I was supposed to wait till the light turns off, but I guess I went up here. Good evening, everybody, and welcome to the Kibbe Science Lecture. My name is Thomas Baumgart. I teach in the Department of Physics and Astronomy here at Bowdoin, and it's my pleasure to introduce our speaker tonight. Before I do that, though, I would like to tell you a little bit about the Kibbe Science Lecture Series, which was created in 1994 by Dr. Frank Kibbe, Bowdoin class of 1937. After receiving his medical training at Johns Hopkins University in Boston Children's Hospital, Dr. Kibbe became a pediatrician in Lincolnville, Maine. He devoted the later part of his career to research, specifically the area of embryo implantation, and his interest in research also led him to establish this series, this lecture series. Our speaker tonight is Dr. Gabriela Gonzalez, who is professor of physics in Louisiana, at Louisiana State University. Dr. Gonzalez is also a leading scientist at the Laser Interferometer Gravitational Wave Observatory, or LIGO for short, and was a driving force behind LIGO's recent detection of gravitational waves from distant black holes. She was a founding member of the LIGO Scientific Collaboration. In 2011, she was elected spokesperson of the group. You'll hear quite a bit more about LIGO tonight and the thrilling and really remarkable discoveries that it has enabled. Dr. Gonzalez was born and raised in Cordoba, Argentina, and she received her licenciatura degree in physics at the University of Cordoba. She then came to the United States and earned her PhD from Syracuse University, focusing her research on Brownian motion and gravitational waves. After working at the Center for Space Research at MIT and teaching at Penn State University, Dr. Gonzalez moved to Louisiana State University, where she has been since 2001. Dr. Gonzalez has received many prizes and awards for her work, many more than you would possibly want me to list tonight. Okay? But among the most impressive of these are the award for the scientific award for the scientific discovery by the National Academy of Sciences, as well as the Gruber Foundation Cosmology Prize. The journal Nature recently selected her as one of the top 10 scientists in the world. Dr. Gonzalez also has been named a Fellow of the American Physical Society, the Institute of Physics, and the International Society of General Relativity and Gravitation. She has been honored with a university prize from her alma mater, the University of Cordoba in Argentina as well. And while I don't want to put too much pressure on her, I also must mention that at one point she was named the Woman Speaker of the Year by the Australian Institute of Physics. So we're truly delighted to have Professor Gonzalez here tonight, all the way from Louisiana, where she tells me spring is almost over. Okay. So please help me welcome Gabriela Gonzalez.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here. I thank you, Thomas, and the university, the college, for inviting me. I like to see snow once in a while, even in almost April. And I'm here to tell you about not just gravitational waves, but Einstein himself and the theory that predicted these. Can you all hear me? Is this better? Okay. Let's hope this doesn't turn around. This story started a long time ago, a billion years ago, more than a billion years ago, when there were two big black holes that, that were rotating around each other. These were 30 times the mass of the sun each. And they were getting closer and closer together because they were warping the space-time around them that was carrying away energy, and they were getting almost traveling at the speed of light when they merged into a single black hole that ran down while these gravitational waves carried the message of this tango dance, as I like to say, and this embrace to the rest of the universe. A billion years ago, on Earth, just multicellular organisms were beginning to grow. That's how long ago this story started. Now, on Earth, a lot of things happened since then. And in about 400 years ago, that's what I begin telling the story, the physics story, Newton, as you probably remember from high school, had a theory on how masses attract each other and what the force of gravity is. And we learned this in school now, and it looks so natural. You probably remember this formula, even if I didn't put it here. He said that all the masses attract each other with a force that's proportional to the product of those masses, inversely proportional to the distance squared. We memorized all of that. But this was revolutionary at the time. And it was because it explained not just mundane motions like an apple falling presumably on his head or the rolling cylinders that go down the incline in the homework problems that we do. It also explained why the Earth goes around the sun and the moon goes around the Earth and the planets go around the sun. So the same gravity law that explains how we trip and how things move in here explains the planetary motions. This was a universal law. It was the first one of these laws that we physicists like very much because they explain lots of things at the same time. Electricity and magnetism are two of those other forces that are also explained very nicely by very simple equations once you become a graduate student. Something that we call Maxwell's equations, and that was the unified theory of electricity and magnetism. That explains light, it explains electromagnetic waves that travel at the speed of light. Now, Einstein, in 1905, he was working, and he had such an intuition for many different physics problems. And in 1905, one of the things he did was to come up with what we call now the special theory of relativity. And that theory was trying to explain electricity and magnetism, that you might remember that magnetic fields are produced not just by magnets, but by electric charges that move. If you have a moving electric charge, it will produce a magnetic field. That was known. But Einstein was always thinking about relative motion. You probably also remember that when we talk about moving motion, we are always thinking about what moves with respect to what. So if we say an electron is producing a magnetic field because it's moving, Einstein was thinking it's moving with respect to what. And it turns out that question is not so simple to solve. And this theory of special relativity says that there are some contradictions that come from applying relative motion to electricity and magnetism, and those contradictions are explained if you assume a few things, like, for example, that light always travels at the speed of light. And that sounds obvious to us, but it's not obvious. If we have a ball and we have it with us, we say, well, it's moving, it's not moving. It has zero velocity. But if we are on a train, and then there's somebody measuring my velocity and the ball velocity, that person will say that we are both moving. And if I throw the ball forward, that person will say that the ball is going to be moving faster. What Einstein said in that theory is that if I have a flashlight on the train, and if I turn on the flashlight, I'm going to measure light going away from me at the velocity of light. And the person on the station is going to measure the speed of light at the speed of light. The light is not going to be moving faster because it's on a train. Sounds strange, but it actually makes sense. It made sense of a lot of a lot of effects that were measured then of light, electric fields, and magnetic fields. But it has it had this one thing about a speed limit. Nothing travels faster than the speed of light. Speed of light is a universal speed limit. And I like driving fast, and I tried it, and I cannot drive faster. Not even close. The problem with that, he came to think about later, is that Newton's theory of gravity says that this force of gravity is traveling faster than the speed of light. It's traveling instantaneously. According to Newton's theory, if the sun disappears, the Earth will immediately begin moving in a straight line. That travels faster than the speed of light, and he didn't like that. So he came up with this very, very complicated but beautiful way of explaining gravity in a way that respects this speed of light, this speed limit with the speed of light, and that's Einstein's gravity. What he says is that there is no such force. What there is that we have masses, all the masses, the sun, the earth, all of us, every mass is living in the fabric of space-time. And now, that's a bit difficult to imagine, but try. First, you imagine two-dimensional space as a grid paper, but a grid paper that can move around, a dynamic grid paper. Now, make that three-dimensional, because there are three dimensions in space. Now put time in here. You can imagine about putting clocks in every corner measuring time, just like the lines measure the grid. And now make it all dynamic. It can all be flexible and moving. That is space-time. And what the masses do is they flex this space-time. They distort space-time proportional to the mass. So if you have the sun, then it will distort space-time like you do when you are on a mattress, on your bed. You distort the mattress. That's what the sun does with the fabric of space-time. And the sun does the same, but a little less, because it's less massive. And the reason why this Earth moves around the sun is because it sees the curvature of space-time. Not because it feels the force of the sun, the instantaneous force of the sun, but because it sees the curvature of space-time, and that makes the Earth go around the sun. So Einstein's theory of relativity came up, general theory of relativity, is a theory of gravity where it comes up with this concept of space-time and masses distorting space-time. And the distortions of space-time tell the masses how to move, but when the masses move, then the distortions of space-time move with those, so it's all dynamic. It's all interacting. That is Einstein's theory of general relativity. Notice that I didn't put a formula here. I have no other formulas in the talk, just Newton's law. Now, there are many predictions of this theory, and Einstein was actually interested in making predictions to see how this could be measured. Like I said, he had a very strong physical intuition. And some of the things that he predicted were, for example, that the universe was expanding. It turns out that if you solve his equations assuming some fluid, like all the stars in the universe making a fluid, then it turns out that the solutions to his equations said that the universe was not static. It was either expanding or compressing. It was moving. And he didn't like that. Nobody knew that. This was 1915. So he actually put a term in his equations to make the universe static. And several years later, decades later actually, astronomers discovered that the universe was indeed expanding. So he took that term away. Turns out that now we think we have to put it back, because the universe is expanding. but accelerating with an expansion that's accelerating, and we don't understand that very well. But anyway, that was one of the predictions. Another prediction was that, and this wasn't his, that was somebody else, Schwarzschild, solving his equations while being in the trenches in the First World War. And he solved Einstein's equations assuming that the universe was, that there was mass, but it was uniform, it was spherically symmetric. And it turns out that the solution is that there is a very singular point where the equations break down, the solution breaks down, and then there's a horizon around that singular point, and anything that's outside that, it will move around this horizon as if there was a regular mass in there. But anything that tries to cross that horizon, it will never come back out. That was a black hole. People didn't believe in that. Einstein didn't believe in that. Astronomers didn't believe in that until there began to be evidence about black holes. There are many scientists that still don't believe in black holes. They are so weird. But we see them. We don't see them because they emit light. We see evidence that they exist because, for example, at the very center of our galaxy, we do see nothing emitting light, but we see stars that are moving around a mass inside, a mass that's very large, but very, very compact. It's a black hole. We don't see the black hole. We see the things around the black hole, proving to us that there is a black hole. It's like seeing the planets without seeing the sun. You would know that there's a sun there, but you wouldn't know it because of the light. You would know it because of gravity. That's how we know about black holes, until we discovered gravitational waves, and now we know a lot more. The first prediction that was actually measured, proven correct and measured, is that light doesn't travel in a straight line. If a beam of light goes close to a mass, like the sun, it will bend. And that's because light is following the shortest path, but the shortest path is curved because the sun is curving space-time. So that was the first prediction that was measured, and it was measured during an eclipse. And what does an eclipse have to do with light? There's no light during an eclipse, right? I mean, that's the whole point. And there's one coming up very soon this year to the U.S. The point is that when you see stars and you want to locate the stars on the sky, you're seeing the stars at night, by definition, right? You're seeing the light of the stars, that is at night. But during an eclipse, you can see the stars during the day because then the light of the sun will be blocked. But the light that's coming from the star will now be going near the sun. While during the night, the sun is on the other side of the earth, so the light from the star will not see the sun. So the location of the star will be different during the night than during an eclipse. Now, this can only be measured for stars that are very near the eclipse, very near the sun, so it's a difficult measure to make. You need to be at a place where not only there is an eclipse, but it's not cloudy. And the first times that this measurement was first attempted, it was cloudy and rainy, and they couldn't do it. But in 1919, this could be done, and this was the first confirmation of Einstein's theory of general relativity, that light really traveled in a bent. Another theory, another prediction, and this I find the most incredible of all, is that masses curve space-time. And we're talking about time, we're talking about clocks. So the Earth curves the space-time around it, and that means that clocks at different distances from the Earth are going to be out of sync. They're going to be running at different rates. And this is a small effect, but this is big enough that most of you, if not all of you, are taking into account right now. GPS, as you may know, works because we triangulate the signals from our device, our phone or our GPS clock, with GPS satellites that are out there. But the satellites and us are at different distances from the Earth. So the clocks are not synced. If you don't take general relativity into account, you get to the wrong address. That's how we are all using general relativity today. Sometimes, if people had asked Einstein, what is your theory good for? He would have said, well, all these things, universe, matter, gravity. But what applications is science good for? That's what we are asked very often. He would have said, we understand the universe better. That's it. But here, now we have GPS thanks to that. That's how technology evolves. That's how science brings us technology. The other prediction, and that's the one I want to tell you more about, is gravitational waves. I told you that Newton predicted that if you have two masses and they start in certain directions, then they are going to be rotating around each other. That's how Newton explained that the Earth goes around the Sun. Actually, the Sun is also doing a little circle around the center of mass. If you have two masses of about the same size, they are going to be both rotating around the center of mass. Now, according to Newton, that will happen forever. According to Einstein, that's not going to be the case. According to Einstein, the masses that are moving, oh, I think I stopped the movie with this clicker. The laser stops it. I'm sorry. The distortions of space-time that these masses are producing when they move are gravitational waves that are carrying energy away from the system. So the stars are getting closer and closer together, and they are going to merge into a single star at the end. And if these two are neutron stars, then they are going to merge and form a black hole. That's a qualitatively different prediction from Einstein's theory than Newton's theory. And these gravitational waves are going to tell us about how that happened. But the first prediction is that the stars are going to get closer. And we can know about some of these systems because there are some stars, like the one I had in here, that are called pulsars. They're called pulsars because they have a radio beam. They emit a radio beam. And as the star rotates, this radio beam goes like that. And then here on Earth, if we are in a lucky position, then we can see the radio beam going on and off, and that's because the light is going on a cone, so we can see it when it goes through the Earth. So we can tell what the star is doing. We can tell how fast it is rotating, but we can also tell whether the star is doing that or just doing this. So we can tell that that star is in a binary system or is just alone rotating around its axis. And in the 70s, well, first of all, I like to say that the fact that there were, that the origin of these radio ticks were neutron stars, or were stars at all, was the work of a graduate student working with her advisor, Jocelyn Bell, in the UK. And the first time that a signal was discovered to come from a binary system was also the work of another graduate student, Roger Hulse, in there, who was working with his advisor, Joe Taylor, a very famous astronomer. And they discovered the first binary system in the 70s, the first binary system of two neutron stars in the 70s. And this system was rotating around with an orbital period of around 8 hours. And they said, that's very fast. Imagine the Earth goes around the sun once a year, and these stars are rotating around each other once every 8 hours, three times a day. And they said, Joe Taylor said, this system is very relativistic. This is moving very fast. So this is going to be losing energy to gravitational waves at a measurable rate. And they kept, Joe Taylor kept measuring it over and over again, and this is a plot of the measurement of a quantity that is proportional to the orbital size that's shrinking, compared with the prediction of general relativity. It's perfect. It's amazing. This kind of test of general relativity is limited now by our limits to measuring time with atomic clocks. That's how good this test is. So we knew gravitational waves existed. We knew that GR theory was good. We still wanted to measure this distortion of gravitational waves here on Earth, because then we can use the measurement of those distortions as a new kind of telescope, as a, do a new kind of astronomy. And some people in the 70s thought that this could be done with interferometers, that these distortions of space-time are distances getting longer and shorter, and absolute measures of distances are very difficult to make, but measuring differences of distances, it's a bit easier, and that can be done with something called an interferometer. How many people here do not know what an interferometer is? Okay. That makes this movie worse. In an interferometer, we have light that's going to travel to a beam splitter. And the beam splitter, like the name says, it's going to split the beam in two. It's going to make half the beam go that way and half the beam go that way. And we put mirrors here, and these mirrors are going to reflect that beam. This mirror is going to reflect that beam. And when this beam gets back here, what is it going to do? It's going to split again. Going to go half that way and half that way. And when this beam comes back from here, it's going to go half this way and half this way. So out here, we are going to have two beams, one coming from here and the other coming from there. And the interference of these two beams, because beams are electromagnetic waves, if these two waves are on top of each other, we're going to have light. If these beams, if these waves are opposite to each other, we are going to have darkness. And the phase of these two beams depends on the difference in distance of these two lengths. And that's what the gravitational wave would do. So let me show you. Movie's always better than words. Almost always. So here it is. If there is let me show you. Here there is a little bit of light, and that's because this distance is a little bit different than that distance. If these two distances are the same, there is no light out here. If these two distances are half a wavelength different, then there's going to be a lot of light out here. So the point is that measuring how much light there is out there, we can measure, we can measure how different these two lengths are. So that was beam of light. Now we imagine that, we know that the laser light is a wave, it's an electromagnetic wave. So when the two waves come here, here they're out of phase because those two distances are the same, we have no light. But if there's a gravitational wave coming through, then those two distances are going to change and we can go from no light to a lot of light. So if we put a photocell out here and measure how much light we have in there, and how that light is changing, we can tell how that distance is changing compared to this distance. Now, how much do we expect this to change? And what is the pattern that we expect. Well, that was something that Einstein himself realized. He predicted the existence of gravitational waves in 1916. 1915 was when he published his general theory of relativity. In 1916, he published a paper predicting gravitational waves, and he said, they're never going to be measured. They are so small. And they are very, very small. They are the effect of the gravitational wave is proportional to the distance you are measuring. So the longer the distance you measure, the larger the change. The shorter, the smaller the change. Gravitational waves produced by the coalescence of two neutron stars forming a black hole in the Virgo cluster, something that would happen once every 50 years or so, would produce a fractional change in distance of 10 to the minus 21. Now, that's small. It has lots of zeros. But how small is that? If you take the distance between the Earth and the Sun, that distance is going to change by about an atomic diameter. And if you have a distance that's smaller than the distance between the Earth and the Sun, it's going to change a lot less. Even then, people in the 70s thought that you could build an interferometer that could be sensitive enough to measure these effects, this 10 to the minus 21, if you made it long enough. How long can you make an interferometer? We have interferometer in our labs. People had built prototype interferometers 40 meters in Caltech, 30 meters in Germany. In the 90s, you or your parents paid taxes, enough taxes, to give to the National Science Foundation to construct two interferometers in the US, one in Louisiana and the other in Livingston, each of which are 4 kilometers long. This is near where I live. I live in Baton Rouge. This is LIGO Livingston in the middle of a logging forest. And 3,000 kilometers away in the state of Washington, in the middle of the desert, there's another detector, another interferometer with 4 kilometers in each side. Here's the laser. It travels 4 kilometers that way to a mirror, 4 kilometers that way to a mirror, and then it comes back, and we have a photocell here to measure that change in distance. Now, 10 to the minus 21, how much does that change 4 kilometers? It changes it by 4/10 to the minus 18 meters. Now, you probably don't carry these numbers off the top of your head, but an atom is 10 to the minus 10 meters. A proton is 10 to the minus 15 meters. We are measuring 4 parts in 1,000 of a proton diameter. People thought this was kind of crazy. But enough people thought that with enough time and technology, this could be done. What did you need? Well, not only 4 kilometers long, but you also needed not just a simple interferometer. There are lots of complicated optical topology. But the laser beam, you needed it to be traveling vacuum so that it doesn't move around due to the Earth and the wind, the currents and drift. You need that beam, that vacuum tube protected from the environment by a concrete enclosure. The mirrors, you need to suspend them so that they are not moving so much and they are free from, they are like free masses, which is how we want to measure things. So we have this pendulum hanging from glass fibers from another pendulum. This is a quadruple pendulum altogether, hanging from a seismic isolation system in which we measure the relative motion between all these layers and we cancel it. We put that on top here. So this is a seismic isolation. That's a quadruple pendulum. These are hydraulic actuators with which we push this whole thing to cancel the Earth tides. And with all of that together, putting all this thing in vacuum, using a powerful laser and lots of tricks, we can measure a part in a thousand of a proton. We've done that. Now, how much, what did we expect? Well, from binary systems, from stars that are turning around each other, we expect to measure a gravitational wave that is something like a sine wave, but as the stars are getting closer and closer together, we know that they are going faster, they are getting closer, so we know we are going to be measuring a shorter period, a higher frequency, a higher amplitude, until these two stars get together. There's a merger, and then there's a single black hole that rings down, and then it either stays quiet or keeps rotating, but that does not produce gravitational waves anymore. Now, we really didn't know what to expect of this merger until about 10 years ago, when there was a breakthrough in numerical relativity, which is people solving Einstein's equations on computers. If you want to solve more complicated equations like those for neutron stars, then you need to put hydrodynamics and radiation and neutrinos, and it's a big mess. But if you only have black holes are just Einstein's equations with mass inside horizons. So those are vacuum equations. How difficult can those be? Well, it took like 40 years. But people managed to get simulations on the computer of black holes merging. And this is one of those. So these are the two black holes. These are the two black holes. And they are, and the color is indicating the curvature of space-time near the black holes. And this line here is indicating the stretching and squeezing of distances far from the black holes. And this is a quarter of a second before coalescence. We can see that the frequency is getting larger, the black holes are getting closer, things are getting crazy. You see the green becoming red, and they are getting closer. This is 10 milliseconds before coalescence. We have slowed down the movie. Things are happening faster and faster. And here, there's just a single horizon that involves the two black holes. And then there's a final black hole that is rotating but not producing gravitational waves anymore. So there are no gravitational waves after the merger. But before the merger and during the merger, we know what is the prediction from black holes. This was actually a revolution in theory because now we knew what to expect. And it took a bit more than 10 years, but on September 14 of 2015, that's exactly what we thought, what we saw. We didn't expect this. In fact, we were calculating our sensitivity to the coalescence of neutron stars, and we knew that it was very, very unlikely that we would see neutron stars with the sensitivity we had yet, because we had still a lot of work to do. But we just wanted to take some data to see what happened out there, if there was anything strange, and indeed, there was. This is what we saw in Livingston. This is a signal from the photodiode in Livingston in blue. And you see something that looks like a sine wave, where the period is getting shorter and the amplitude is getting larger, and then it rings out. So this is noise. This is a regular noise that we see. This is a regular noise that we see. But here, in this fraction of a second, look at the time in here. This is just a fraction of a second. We seem to see a gravitational wave. But 3,000 kilometers away, and 7 milliseconds later, in Hanford, this is what we saw. It was It is the orange signal, and then you can see it going with the blue signal. That was space-time getting stretched and squeezed around the Earth, and we were measuring it at the same time in these two detectors. And look at the unit here, 10 to the minus 21. That is the fractional distance. This is 4 parts in 1,000 of a proton diameter. And this is 2 parts in 1,000 of a proton diameter. That is the sensitivity we have with these detectors. This frequency, this wave pattern, we knew because of the predictions that it had to be produced by 2 merging black holes. We could calculate how much energy was emitted in gravitational waves at that time. This wave pattern is telling us that we had 29 solar masses and 36 solar masses merging into a single black hole of 62 solar masses. And this is where somebody should call me up and say, you're not doing the arithmetic right. 29 plus 36 is 65. And I said 62. And I'm right because 3 solar masses of energy went away in gravitational waves following that famous formula. What is the formula that you all know from Einstein? It's E equal mc squared. 3 solar masses of energy got converted into energy, mc squared. That's how much energy went out in this fraction of a second. That's more energy than in the visible light of the whole universe on that fraction of a second. We couldn't believe it. It took us a few months, but we convinced ourselves. We did all the numbers. It turned out to be this 29 and 36 and 62. We convinced that there was no hacker that produced this. That's something that we worried about. We calibrated our detectors to make sure that this 10 to the minus 21 was actually right. Like I said, it took us a few months, but on February 11th, we were able to say, we did it. We were so happy that Ray Wise, Franz Cordova, the director of the National Science Foundation, Ray Wise talking about this to a big press conference. I think some of you might have heard about this at the time. It had a great reaction, not just in the scientific community, but in the public. And that was amazing to us, very, very satisfying, and very funny too. We discovered only a couple of months later that a fashion designer, Holly something is called, has a company called Shinova. She produced this gravitational wave dress. Can you recognize? I have a model. It doesn't fit me as well as that. But we all love it. We call it the gravity dress. In New York City, we found in the subway, these are people that had nothing to do with us. We don't know. We didn't know these people. I don't know these people now. There was an ad for storage space saying, scientists found gravitational waves in outer space. If only it were that easy to find an apartment in New York City with a walk-in closet. Everybody was talking about gravitational waves. And that's because everybody's interested in science. When the newspapers talk about science, everybody wants to learn. Everybody's excited. And it was a bit shameful that we discovered it after the fact, but that's why we are so happy to talk about this all the time. Now, this is all done not just by these 4 people who were here announcing it, or even the 1,000 people signing the paper. There have been many, many people, hundreds and hundreds of people, 1,000 now, but many hundreds that have gone through this through the decades. At this time, the LIGO Scientific Collaboration has more than 90 institutions, 1,100 members in 15 different countries, and we all work together to develop the technology for future detectors. That's what people did 20 years ago for the detectors we have today. We analyze the data, we operate the detectors, we all give homework to each other, and we all work together. And this is how this kind of science, at least, is done today. And we are very proud of how successful we have been. Now, this is a long story. It started with Einstein. There was previous attempts at detecting gravitational waves. The whole field started with Joe Weber in the 60s with a different technology to measure. Kip Thorne and Ray Wise starting this quest to use interferometers. The LIGO scientific collaboration, the first two spokespersons were Ray Wise and Peter Solson. I love that picture because they were my two mentors, my PhD advisor from Syracuse University and my postdoctoral advisor. But this is the kind of people, when you think of a scientist, you probably think of Einstein or Sheldon Cooper. These are the scientists that you have to think about. We are young and old, women are men, all kinds, all sizes, all colors, all countries. This is science today, and that's the way we like it. Now, that detection I told you about was not the last one. It was the first one. We took data for 4 months. We saw this detection very early on September 14, but on December 26, we saw another detection, not as big amplitude as the first one, but a bit longer, because it came from two smaller black holes. So two smaller black holes take a bit longer. They merge at a bit higher frequency, so we have them in band for a bit longer. So we saw this twice. We even saw another signal that might be a gravitational wave signal. This was smaller amplitude. It seemed to be from a system. If it was an astrophysical signal, it would be from a system of black holes that is farther away. It's consistent with the other two, but by itself, it has a 15% chance of being just an accidental coincidence, just noise in the system. So we're not so sure. But we have two for sure. In 4 months of data, of which we had about 40 days of coincidence. So let me let you listen to these signals. We call this gravity's music. If you put the signals in a speaker, that was a long one. This is a short one. Then again, December, September. We didn't think that sounded musical enough, so we added 400 hertz. This is kind of like cheating, but I told you the truth first, so that's okay. That's our music. So now we have a dress and we have music. But this is about science, and this is actually a whole new way of doing astronomy. We knew black holes existed. We knew that black holes are born small from the merger of two neutron stars or the explosion of supernovas. They are born with a few solar masses. We knew that. We know they get very big at the center of the galaxies. We know there are black holes with a million solar masses. We knew there were black holes that were smaller from X-ray studies, because some black holes emit beams, emit jets, and we can learn something about the black holes from that. And they have some companion stars from which they are accreting mass. And the mass that's falling into the black hole is emitting X-rays. So the black hole itself does not emit any light, but the matter around it does, usually in the X-rays. And from that, we can infer the mass of these. And the biggest ones were about 20, 25 solar masses. And not everybody agreed on those being black holes. Our first detection, I told you, it had 29 and 36 before they became 62 solar masses. So these were huge. People, astronomers, are now fighting over each other and trying to explain how these black holes are produced. Because it means that there are lots of binary systems. Maybe they cluster, they get all together in the center of clusters. Maybe they are stars exploding in a common envelope. We don't know yet. I say, well, let us take some more data. We'll tell you later. This was our first detection. Our December detection was more in line with these others. Our candidate is in between those two. So this is the kind of science that we are doing now. We are doing a new kind of astronomy. Now, when you think of astronomy, you probably think about pointing somewhere, pointing a telescope like Galileo did or the radio dish. We don't point our telescopes. We have these 4-kilometer detectors, and the 4-kilometer detectors go with the Earth around it, but they are like microphones. They can detect gravitational waves from almost any direction in the sky, which means you cannot tell where they come from. If you have two detectors, then there is a time difference, so you kind of know where they come from. They come from a circle in the sky. And from the phase difference between the two detectors, you can kind of say, well, it comes from this part of the circle rather than that part of the circle. But this is not very good astronomy yet. We know the masses, we can learn about the spins, but we cannot quite tell the location of these until we get more detectors. Because if you have three detectors, you can triangulate at least. You have a triangle. And we are collaborating with the Virgo collaboration that has a detector in Italy. The LIGO collaboration has also a detector in Germany, but it's not as sensitive, so we cannot use it to detect these signals. But this one is 3 kilometers long, and they will begin operating later this year with us. So we are hoping that perhaps this year we will have the first detections with 3 detectors telling us about localization. We hope, you can only hope. We only have 2 detections, so extrapolating from 2 events is a bit dangerous, but eventually it will happen. And the detectors are going to get better. We are still not at the potential sensitivity that we want to be. We are about 3 times better than we were 10 years ago, but we want to be 10 times better. And we can be there in a few years. And there's another detector in Japan being built that we'll be working in about a few years. There's another observatory approved in India that we'll be working in about a bit less than 10 years. So we will have a network. We will have much better localized signals and many more detections. This is coming to a home theater near you very soon. And we are not just looking for black holes or binary systems. We are looking for transients, short transients, like supernova explosions in our galaxy. We are looking for rotating stars producing periodic waves in our galaxy. We are looking for binary systems, not just from black holes, but neutron stars and black holes. And we are looking for an astrophysical noise. The early universe produced a stochastic background of gravitational waves, which is predicted to be very, very small, much below our noise, but who knows? We are looking. Maybe we'll see something. Even if we don't see the early cosmological background, we might see a background produced by a lot of black holes merging that we don't resolve from each other. And then our signal will become noise, depending on who describes it. And this is what's happening with the network of detectors I told you about. But there are other detectors that can detect gravitational waves of other wavelengths. Just like light comes in many colors, gravitational waves come in many wavelengths. Larger black holes produce gravitational waves of much longer periods. So black holes at the center of galaxies would produce gravitational waves of periods of minutes to hours, And we will detect those with a space detector that's in the planning. It has a launching date of 2034, but I'm hoping they will accelerate that a bit. We can detect gravitational waves from billion solar mass black holes and perhaps from the early universe, looking at these radio beams coming from these neutron stars in the galaxies. Because then you can use those radio beams as the beams of your interferometer. So now you have a detector. This one is 1 million kilometers long. This is 4 kilometers long. This can be parsecs long. It has galactic scale. And the early universe, well, that's the most difficult one. We might see something with this, but probably the best bet will be to see the imprint of those early gravitational waves on the microwaves that we see now from the early universe. You might have heard that we have been measuring something, the cosmic microwave background from the early universe. It turns out that those are photons that are bringing us information from then. The polarization of those photons, which is much more difficult to measure, would carry information about the early gravitational waves. And this is also done by many experiments that are probably going to come out with results in the next few years. So this is the decade of gravitational waves. This is the beginning of gravitational waves astronomy. The future is very, very gravity bright. Thank you. There are two microphones for questions, and I measure the success of a talk by the number of questions. So please do ask.
Good evening. I was thinking about this lecture, so this is a slightly prepared question.
That's okay.
In a few billion, this is a hypothetical. In a few billion years, so I've heard, we're going to have a crash with the Andromeda galaxy. If, perchance, the black hole in our Milky Way and the black hole in the Andromeda galaxy happened to merge, we're 28,000, give or take a few thousand light years from the center of the Milky Way. Given that those two black holes come together and go whoomp, the one you were talking about was a billion years away. In that connection, what would we be feeling?
A lot of stretching and squeezing, but not as much as you think. We hope to have a lot more evidence from this kind of experiment. This kind of experiment will be measuring gravitational waves from black holes at the center of galaxies merging. Our galaxy will take a few billion years to merge with another, but there are other galaxies that are merging right now. So we will see gravitational waves from those, and we will be able to tell you how strong those are. I'm not afraid, though.
So you've mentioned here that there's, I guess, a bunch of different experiments for measuring gravitational waves. But now that, I guess, the LIGO project has succeeded in its goal in detecting gravitational waves.
Started succeeding.
Yeah. Is there some sort of, I guess, end goal for the experiment, or is it just going to, continue on in whatever, I guess, direction gravitational waves take physics?
Oh, we have lots of plans. We have ways of, we have ideas on how to make the detectors in these facilities more and more sensitive. We think that we can make the better detectors if we make them longer, if we make them underground, if we make them cryogenic, if we begin manipulating the quantum nature of the laser light that we put in there. If we do all of that together, the project in Japan is an underground cryogenic project. The other aspects are simpler, so the sensitivity of that project will be about the same as what we have now. But then if we just teach each other technology, and we are all sharing technology all the time, then we will have better detectors. So we will be measuring not just more and more signals, but signals from different sources, from larger black holes. For example, people call it the mass gap, because people don't think there are two mass gaps. There is one for what people call intermediate mass black holes, between 100 or a few hundred solar masses and 1 million solar masses. We don't know how those could form. We have trouble already explaining how our first detection could happen. So we will be able to count on those if we improve our detectors enough at low frequency. I think that the most exciting thing will be to measure the unknown. And once we do that, if that first signal had not been like that, but it had been like this, going down and up again, and we had seen it 7 milliseconds apart at that amplitude, the same in Hanford and Livingston, we would have had to say, these are gravitational waves. We don't know what they are, where they're coming from, but they are. And we would want the detector to be more and more sensitive, even at those frequencies. So that is all happening with this. There are decades and decades of work to do with ground-based detectors.
And also, you mentioned that because we only have two detectors so far that are sensitive enough to detect, that we can't figure out exactly where these black holes were. And I guess this is more a question of how gravitational radiation or waves stretch space-time, but because we don't know exactly what direction they're coming from, these gravitational waves are coming from, is there some sort of Doppler effect that I guess may create an error in how massive the black holes are and how much energy they're releasing that we can't, I guess, quite figure out because we don't have three observatories yet?
Well, it's not just because of three observatories, but there's some of that. The Doppler effect due to the Earth rotation and the Earth motion, that is negligible because these signals are so short, fraction of a second, that the Earth doesn't move much in there. But the universe is expanding. So we should see the red shift of these gravitational waves. However, even though 400 megaparsecs or 1 billion light years sound like a very long distance, in astronomical terms, that would have a redshift of only about 10%, depending on what theory you use. But we don't know what the redshift of the signals. And we wouldn't know even with more detectors. We could only know if we have lots and lots and lots of signals, some with electromagnetic counterparts, which may not be black holes, but a neutron star and a black hole, we expect that sometimes they would emit light that would come to us. In general, the light would be beamed, but if we are lucky, that beam would come to us, the electromagnetic beam. So we would see light and gravitational waves, lights and sound, and then we would get more information. But that's the kind of things we need for knowing things like redshift or Doppler shift because of the expansion of the universe.
Go ahead.
Thank you for that great talk. It was really terrific to hear the overview of everything. You talked today in the department about how you extract this signal from the noise. And one of the points you made in the department talk was that it helps to extract the data from the noise if you have a good model of what the data is going to look like. And so you talk about the benefit of the numerical simulations, which give you sort of model data that you can use to find correlations under your noise in the data. If the modeling gets better and you have lots more predictive models for all kinds of different events, do you think you might be able to go back to the data that you already have and extract additional events from the existing data? Or does progress in the field rely on collecting newer data with a lower noise floor in order to see the next set of events?
That's a good question. I wish I could say yes. My hunch, it's a hunch, is that what theory will help us the most is for interpreting what happens at the merger. Because before the merger, for binary systems, we do have good approximations, analytical approximations, and then we can use that to get the main parameters. So if we get enough in spiral signal, which we didn't for this first detection, right? This first detection was just a couple of cycles or a few cycles. But for signals, we do expect to have most of the signal, even for that one, from the spiral part. And for that, we have good approximations. So what better simulations will give us, better theory will give us, is details on the merger. But I don't think that they will be able to add much to the signal-to-noise ratio that we get for detecting the signal. So they will tell us more. They will certainly tell us more about the signals we have seen. I wouldn't bet on finding signals that we have missed. But I don't know.
So my question is actually about the cosmological redshift of these gravitational waves, which you largely answered. So thank you, Professor Masalda, for giving me a little time to think more about the question. So specifically, I was wondering, based on the number of cycles and how the strength of the wave changes over the period when you're actually measuring the signal, I would have thought that you would be able to determine a lot of the physics about the actual coalescence or the event, besides actually knowing the frequency. And so I was wondering if the cosmological redshift from different events would actually expand the range of different types of events that you could look at based on the fact that there is a very specific range of frequency where the detection is optimal. So based on how close an event is, does the redshift actually help or hurt how accurately we're able to determine what happened?
That's a very good question. I haven't thought about that. I don't think so, because we're talking orders of magnitude, right? If we are talking something that was out of band and it's moved in band, you're talking at least a factor of 2 in frequency, but probably more like an order of magnitude, which means that you would be looking at a redshift of 10. And at that distance, signals would be very, very, very weak. So perhaps in the 4th or 5th generation of technology, we are only in the 2nd one.
You said the redshift was only about 10% for the events that we've seen.
That right. Astronomers sometimes measure the distances in redshift. So the signals that we detected were at redshift of 0.1.
Okay.
The most distant objects in the universe that have been looked at had redshift of a few, 10. And at that level, then the redshift is changing the wavelength by a factor of 10. So that would make something out of band get in band. But then it would have to be very, very far away.
Okay. Thank you.
I'm just curious about your optimism for kind of the rate of growth of this field. You talked about you have the satellites going up in 2034, you said. But I was just curious, because you read about 100 to 50 years ago where you have our theoretical physicists who are doing work largely independently or in their small groups the big names you read about, Feynman and Einstein, and seeing what you're doing now with these large teams across the nation and across countries, do you think we're reaching any sort of stasis where the funding isn't going to be able to support any more physicists and the rate is going to slow down? Or are we still increasing and you think it's actually going to get more data and more development from more teams across the country and globe?
Well, I think you can, I like to extrapolate from the last, I don't know, 20, 30 years in science. And the advances in science have accelerated. They have not slowed down. Science becomes more expensive because the frontier, we keep pushing the frontier, so some of the experiments that we think about keep getting more expensive, but we keep getting better at it. We keep so now we have to choose which of the expensive experiments we want to do, but that's because there are many to do, not just in physics. Of course, my favorite field is gravitational wave physics, but you see advances in all the sciences in many different areas. So no, I don't think science is slowing down. I know funding is difficult, but if you measure this, I mean, you measure advances in decades. So things go up and down. I believe in oscillations. The harmonic oscillator is a basic entity in physics. So funding comes and goes in cycles, but the advancement of science and the progress of advancement has become accelerating in the last decades, and I think it's going to continue that way. So I'm an optimist.
Hi. As the gravitational waves propagates through space-time, does it ever get distorted or changed based off of the space-time that it's going through? And if so, how would that like complicate the information that you can extract from that, from your gravitational wave detection?
Right. In principle, yes. So if the gravitational wave is space-time, so it's not right. That it travels on space-time. It is space-time, but right. it is a perturbation that's moving. So if it goes near a black hole, then it might be lensed. it will be curved, but then it will get back. So unless... If you are looking at the gravitational wave, if our gravitational wave had been coming from a direction where there was a very big black hole right there, we might have been a lensing effect. But that would have been a lot more luck than what we had in measuring such a big signal. Because even for visible signals, it only happens to a very, very small fraction of the lights of the stars that we see. Other than lensing, the scattering of light, it usually happens because you have photons interacting with atoms. Now, gravitational waves interact with atoms, but very, very, very weakly. That's why they're so difficult to measure. So the universe is mostly transparent, and that's why we could see here what we predicted if there hadn't been anything in between us and those black holes. It's because the universe is transparent for the most part.
Hi, thanks for the wonderful talk. I had a question about sort of real-time detection. What are the challenges for sort of figuring out quickly whether you have a detection or not and whether you can trigger for other telescopes to look for the electromagnetic signature of these?
Well, I didn't mention that, but we are doing that. We have codes that run, we call it real-time. It's more like a few minutes. So within 20 minutes or so, I get a text message. saying there's something in the detector. However, we get lots and lots of false alarms. So what we have done is set a very low threshold in significance, and then we send these alerts. We veto them by hand, and we have discovered quite a few that were just bogus. I mean, they were just clearly artifacts of the detector. Some others that we said, we don't know, it might be, but these kind of coincidences happen once a month, So they're not, they would not be very significant just for us, but maybe if there is a coincidence. So we send them out anyway. So we are doing that already. We are still, because we are still doing this human vetoing and because the detectors are still very glitchy and we are not so, we don't have enough self-confidence yet to do it all automatically. We are being careful. But we think that we are taking data now since November 13th in what we are calling the second observing run. We will be taking data for several months, alerting our astronomers that have agreements with us. But in what we call the third observing run, when we think that we will know about our detectors better, we will have better sensitivity, we will be just publishing public alerts as soon as we can with strong detections, with detections that have a false alarm rate of once per 100 years or so. So we are going that way.
Thank you.
Well, that was a great set of questions. Thank you again.